my pleasure to be here among such a distinguished audience. Together, we can actually change the world tomorrow. So obviously, we need to work together. We need to collaborate in order to change, to co-create tomorrow. But we also need some help. And one of these tools that we need help from in the future, in the near future, is artificial intelligence. So today, I am going to talk to you about how do you unlock the full potential of artificial intelligence. And basically, my presentation will be broken into four parts. First is to understand AI. You have to understand how it works in order to fully leverage its power. You have to understand the AI market, which is actually very complex today. Okay, everybody say they do AI. What is it anyway? And you need to know how to pick the right AI technology for you. And finally, you need to learn how to work with AI, because we cannot change tomorrow alone. So we need to work together with other people, but we also need to work with machine as well, right? Bühler produced many, many of the machines that actually makes our work much more efficient today. So in the future, we also need to leverage artificial intelligence to make our work much more efficient to change the world. Okay, so in order to understand AI, we have to ask the question, where did AI actually come from? AI actually come from BI, okay? It's the other way around, you know? So we have to understand what BI really is. So let's take a look at how business intelligence evolved over the last, I would say, 20, 30 years. So first, it just comes with data, right? Because business intelligence is all about presenting you data. And basically, when you have so much data that you cannot look at every single data point, you basically compute some kind of statistic to summarize data for you, okay? So these are, I would say, simple statistics like local trends, global trends, resistance point, indicators that help you understand what the data is actually doing so that you can understand the data without actually looking at every single data point. Okay, so these are what we call descriptive analytics. It simply summarizes data that you already have. Okay? And after you do this for a while, you start to say that, well, I could do a little bit better. I could actually start build a model for this data, right? And then that's that blue dotted line there. Okay, so you could build a model for this data. The model summarizes data also, but what's the advantage of having a model? The advantage of having a model is that now you can actually extrapolate to regions where you don't have data yet, right? In this case, you are extrapolating to the future, right? So in that case, you actually move into what we call predictive analytics. You start being able to forecast, all right? And of course, you continue to do your descriptive stuff, right? And but what's the advantage of having an eye into the future? If you have a crystal ball, what would you do? You could tell people what to do, right? You could start telling people, say, hey, you know what? If you want to make money, that's actually a very good time to buy, right? And actually, you know, this is actually a very good time to sell, right? If you have an eye into the future, you could tell people what to do, right? So this is what we said, what we call prescriptive analytics. You are basically prescribing actions for people to take, okay? So that's actually, I would say, a very simplified history, evolution of business intelligence. You have gone from basically descriptive to predictive to prescriptive, okay? So now let's take a look at a little bit of, dive deeper to understand what each one of these analytics really mean, to understand where AI actually come from, okay? So descriptive analytics is basically just summarizing data. Like as I said before, right? Now, predictive analytics, right? So basically, any data visualization is basically descriptive analytics, right? Now, predictive analytics is all about estimation, okay? It's about building a model and then using data that you have to make an estimate of the data that you don't have, right? When you look at this, this way of looking at predictive analytics, what you may ask yourself, well, what about forecasting? Right? I mean, when people talk about predictive analytics, what comes to mind immediately is people think about, isn't that all about forecasting? Yes, it is, right? But forecasting is a special case in this case, right? Forecasting, the data, you know, the data that you have is basically historical data. And the data that you're trying to estimate that you don't have is future data, okay? So that is, so basically, predictive analytics is all about using data that you have to make an estimate of data that you don't have. All right? So what are some other examples that you know of that is actually predictive analytics? Some other example could be, for example, age estimation, right? So I actually went into a Microsoft office one time, and they have a video camera filming me, and it actually is able to use this image of what I look like to estimate how old I was, okay? Obviously, it gets it not very precisely, okay? So get it wrong, not very precisely, but it's using data that they have, which is image, right, to make an estimate of data that they don't have, which is age, right? You could also make, for example, demographic inference, right? So, for example, you may have speech data, and you're trying to infer whether this is a male or female speaking or writing, right? So in French or in Japanese, it's actually very easy to determine whether a man or woman is actually writing this text, because actually, you know, the self-reference is different. Right, in Japanese, people, if you refer to yourself as boku, most likely you are a male. If you refer to yourself as watashi, you probably are a female, right? Okay, so that's a way to kind of, the data that you have is maybe text, right? And data that you want to estimate is gender or other demographics, right? And for some, there's other examples that you may heard of in marketing. Sentiment analysis is also a form of predictive analytics. Anybody heard of sentiment analysis? Give me a show of hand. Some of you do, right? So those of you who work in marketing or probably know sentiment analysis. Sentiment analysis is actually used in political polling historically, right? They're trying to get people's opinion about a particular candidate, right? Whether they're going to be elected or not. So they get people's opinion about this candidate. But today it's used in marketing to gauge people's consumers' opinions about a product or brand. Okay, so what do? The data that they have is basically text. Any text could be a blog article, could be a news article, right? Could be a tweet, could be a LinkedIn post, right? Could be any text. And basically, that's the data that they have. And the data that they're trying to estimate is people's opinion. Do you like this product? Do you like this brand? Right? What do you feel about this brand? Right? That's the data that you're trying to estimate. So that's predictive analytics. So to understand predictive analytics, you just have to ask yourself, what data are they using to make an estimate of what data that they don't have, that they want to have? Okay? Very simple, right? All right. Now, next, let's move into prescriptive analytics. Prescriptive analytics is all about optimization. Okay? Now, the simplest example of a prescriptive analytic is this GPS navigation system. Now, you all use GPS navigation system, right? What did GPS navigation system do? Basically, you can tell me where you want to go, and then the GPS navigation system will prescribe you a sequence of action to get there. That's what prescriptive analytics is about. It's about prescribing actions for you to take so that it gets to where you want to get to, right? Okay? So there's actually many examples of prescriptive analytics in our life, okay? But let's think about why is prescriptive analytics system all about optimization? Why is it about optimization? You have to ask yourself, why does it actually prescribe this particular route going from here to here, right? There's actually infinite number of routes go from this point to this point, right? You could kind of go around the river, kind of come out on the other side. You could go around this and come back on the other side. You could even go around the globe and come back to the other side too. Why do you think it prescribed this particular route? What? Yeah, shortest distance, right? Early GPS actually optimizes for the shortest distance. That's why they prescribed this particular route. But today, GPS is actually a lot smarter, right? They actually optimize some other objective functions, such as time, right? The shortest travel time. So every day, you may actually prescribe you a different route, because every day, the fastest route may be different, right? Because of, based on traffic patterns and weather, right, conditions, right? The fastest route may be different every day, right? So now, that's why when you actually look at prescriptive analytics, you just have to ask yourself, what are they optimizing underneath to understand what it's actually doing, right? So prescriptive analytics, they prescribe this particular route because this is optimizing for some objective function, right? So some of the examples that we know of, for example, is, for example, search engine. Search engine is also prescriptive analytics because there's infinite number of websites that you could look at, just like in this case, this infinite number of routes to get from A to B. Why did it prescribe just 10 for you in your search engine result? What is Google optimizing? Relevance, right? Google is optimizing relevance, right? That's why they prescribe you those 10, okay? There are also other examples, such as recommender systems, right? Such as Netflix or Amazon, right? If you go there, they will recommend product for you. By this infinite number of music that you could listen to, infinite number of movie that you could watch, infinite number of product that you could buy, why do you prescribe those for you? What is like Netflix trying to optimize? They're trying to optimize the similarity of your preference to the content, right? That's what they're optimizing. If you like horror movie, they're going to show you a lot of horror movie, right? They're optimizing that similarity. That's why they prescribe those to you, okay? So that's prescriptive analytics. So now, hopefully, you have a very good understanding of what the history of business analytics. It has gone from descriptive to predictive to prescriptive. The question is, what comes next? What's next, right? Now, next is really artificial intelligence, right? But what is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is really just the automation of decisions and proper execution of subsequent action. Okay, that's what it is, okay? Now, basically, in picture, going from data to decision to action, that traditionally is a human's job. We decide what to do, regardless of what the data show us, right? Your GPS could tell you, you need to make a left here to go home. You could say, I don't want to follow this. I want to go straight. I want to stop by the grocery shop, right? Your predictive analytic may show you that this stock is going to tank tomorrow. You better sell it. You could say, I don't believe it. I'm going to keep it, right? We decide what to do, even though business intelligence can tell us what we should do. We make the final decision, right? But if you have data driving decision, driving actions automatically, completely in automatic fashion, right? That's the beginning of AI. And this is already here today, right? Algorithmic trading. You could tell me what stock to buy, when to buy, what stock to sell, when to sell, right? But why? Why do you want me to click the buy and sell button? You could just buy and sell for me, right? You're automating this decision. Then that's AI, right? In fact, it's actually better that way, right? Because if it actually tells me that I should buy a certain stock right now, right? But I can't check my phone, I'm speaking right now, right? By the time I'm able to check my phone, the market conditions already changed, right? It's no longer optimal anymore, right? So it's better to just have the machine trade the buy and sell on my behalf, right? How many people here use robo-advisor to manage their finance? Some do, okay? I do. I don't have time to manage my finance. So basically, this robot is trading on my behalf, okay? So same thing as, for example, automated loan origination, right? Why do you need a person to check off all these boxes in order to give a person's loan? If you meet the criteria, just give them the loan, right? Okay? So now let's go back to the geospatial domain. Let me see if you guys are paying attention. What's the simplest example of a prescriptive analytics system again? GPS, right? So GPS tell you what to do to get home, right? So why tell me what to do to get home? Just take me home, right? It's automating these decisions and actions that you would have taken. That's the beginning of AI, okay? I said this is the beginning, the inception of AI, because this is not truly AI yet, because, you know, obviously, the self-driving car, the autonomous vehicle, is still not very safe, right? People still get killed from it, right? So, right, it's not very safe yet, right? So the real question is, what makes AI smart, right? So for that, we can actually have a little definition of what AI really is, right? So keep in mind that this definition is actually changing over time, right? In fact, the definition of AI is constantly changing over time, okay? So some people said that AI is whatever machine can do today that they could not do in the past, okay? So like when optical character recognition was invented, OCR, remember OCR? Back in the days, right? Machine can read print. Not only can they read print, it can read handwritings. Not only can it read my handwriting, it can read your handwriting, and his handwriting, and her handwriting too, right? Wow, that's AI, right? But today, OCR, you could do that on your phone. Nobody considers that AI anymore, right? So take this definition with a grain of salt, okay? So today, at this point in time, the way I like to look at AI is that it is really just a machine mimicry of human decision and behaviors, okay? With two important criteria. One is automation, the ability to automate decisions and subsequent actions, right? So that's one component. You already see some examples of that. I show you that, right? The other component that's really, really important that I haven't talked about is learning. It has to have the ability to learn and improve its performance with usage. Every time you use it, it has to get better at what it's doing, okay? That's what makes AI truly smart, okay? All right, now what's not AI, okay? This is actually a confusion in the industry. Machine learning is not AI, okay? Just because you use machine learning to build a model doesn't mean you automatically have AI. And this is actually a big confusion in the industry because of this image that's actually very popular. A lot of people would say that, you know, oh, I'm sure if you actually Google for any one of these topics, deep learning, machine learning, or AI, you see this image. In fact, this image is in Wikipedia. It's got to be right? If it's on Wikipedia, right? Okay, it's not quite right, okay? It's not completely wrong either, but you have to interpret it correctly, okay? So deep learning, in fact, is a kind of machine learning, okay? However, machine learning is actually not a kind of AI, okay? Machine learning is actually used in every AI system today. So machine learning is actually a part of AI, right? But it's not a kind of AI, okay? So a lot of people actually misunderstood that, you know, say that machine learning is actually part of AI. It's you know, so it kind of makes sense to put machine learning inside AI because it's part of AI, but you have to carefully tell people what this boundary actually means, okay? If you don't tell people what this boundary means, people can misinterpret this image, and that's something really bad could happen, right? So for this audience, I thought I'd use an example that most people probably understand is, for example, V8 is a kind of engine, right? And the engine is actually used in every car, right? So an engine is actually part of every car. Now, if I don't carefully label these boundaries here, right, you may misinterpret this image saying that, oh, an engine is a kind of car. You know an engine is not a kind of car, right? That's stupid. Engine is not a kind of car, right? Same thing could happen, okay? So machine learning is part of AI, but it's not a kind of AI, okay? So throw away this picture, okay? The picture that you should have is a little more complex, but not that much more, okay? It starts with big data. Big data, basically, we turn data scientists like myself, we turn this big data into a model, okay? And we use a very powerful tool to help us do this. The tool that we use is machine learning. Okay? Machine learning is both a verb and also a noun. As a noun, it's really just a bunch of algorithms that people use. Okay? And keep in mind that you see that, you know, deep learning is in fact a kind of machine learning. It's a type of machine learning, right? Okay? But there's many, many other machine learning algorithms too. Even decision tree is a machine learning algorithm, right? So now, as a verb, it's really just a process of turning data into a model. That's what data scientists do. Machine learning is the process of turning data into a model, okay? Now, once you have a model, what do? You produce, you feed it with new data, it will give you some results, right? People have to look at those results and decide what to do, right? Some decision have to be made. And usually that results in some kind of action. Actions in the real world lead to some kind of outcome. Now, this outcome has to be fed back into your system in order for the system to work well, right? What happens when you don't have this feedback? Think about in the case of a geospatial example of a GPS. Do you know what the feedback is for the user? It's that blue dot that shows you where you are, okay? Imagine how good a GPS when you don't have that blue dot. It's not gonna be very useful, right? Okay? So, as I said earlier, regardless of what the data actually shows you, right, traditionally human makes a decision. We make the decision on what to do, right? And actions in the digital world are, I would say, can be largely automated by machine already. But in the physical world today, a lot of those actions are still taken and carried out by human, right? And feedback traditionally is collected by human as well. And we basically survey to collect this feedback, right? Survey is obviously very, very slow, right? So it's not going to be very, very fast. So if this feedback is not immediate, the system actually don't work very well, right? Think back on the GPS example again, right? What happened when that blue dot updates itself with a 3-minute delay? Do you think your GPS is going to be helpful for you? It's not going to be very helpful, right? It's going to tell you turn left here, and then it's going to say, sorry, there's a wall here. I can't really do anything, right? So so this feedback ideally should happen in real time, right? This had to happen in real time. So the first thing we need to do is to change this feedback mechanism to be automated. It had to be tracked automatically by the machine, right? So this already can be done today, right? Definitely in the digital world, it's very, very easy. People just have to write some code, right, to track those outcome, right? Even in the physical world today, for example, in Bühler, I went to the solution space there, a lot of machines are actually equipped with IoT, right? The operation of the machine is already tracked automatically, right? So it knows when it's working well, when do you need maintenance, all this in advance, right? System works much better, right? Okay, so now when this model here, right, then this model here is good enough, right? This decision here can be automated as well. But the question is, how do you know if a model is good enough? How do you determine if a model is actually good enough? The model is good enough if it's match a human expert's decision pretty much all the time. That's when it's good enough, right? If it's not, then the model can improve, right? So, but if it's matching the human expert's decision all the time, pretty much all the time, why do you need to have the final say? Why do humans have to have the final say? Basically, we could just automate this, right? Because if you have the final say, you'd be saying, I agree with the machine pretty much all the time. I agree, I agree, I agree, I agree, I agree, right? Pretty much all the time. Why do that? Why waste time, right? Just automate it, right? Of course, if you disagree with the machine, right, you could always override, right? That's why there's still a little bit of sliver of yellow here, right? If you disagree, you could always override, right? All right, now in the digital world, pretty much everything here is automated. There's actually no human involvement, except in the rare cases when humans disagree with the machine, okay? So what's the implication of this? The implication is that, well, there's two implications. One is that this loop can actually go very, very fast, okay? The second is that because everything is tracked by machine, so everything is digitized. You have data. And all this data can be fed back into your big data store, right? Could be added to your big data. Now you have new data in your big data, okay? Now if you have big new data, you can actually feed this data into your machine learning process. You get a new model, pretty much, in an automatic fashion, right? You could do this completely automated, but usually it's not a good idea. You want to do this semi-automated, okay? Where they have to have some human supervision. I have many examples where this could go wrong if you run this completely automatic fashion. Now, if you actually use a system over and over again, right? Think about what happened. Basically, every time you use this system, right? You're going to generate new data, and this data gets actually added to your new data, and through machine learning, you're going to get an updated model. So every time it's updating the model, so the model becomes better and better. It becomes a better and better model every time you use it. Okay? So this model becomes really, really good at like modeling this decision to action to outcome process. And this is what we call the learning loop. This is actually how AI learn and how AI becomes smart. Okay? It's through this feedback loop. Okay? It's called the learning loop. All right? Okay, so I just want to illustrate the power of this learning loop with this example. So anybody heard of this story? Right? A program written by human, it's called AlphaGo, okay, is able to beat the world champion in the game of Go. Okay, how is it able to do that? I mean, the people who write the program, some of them may not even play Go, right? And the data that they use to train the AlphaGo is definitely not nowhere near the world champion's skill, right? So how are they able to beat the world champion? This is when things become really, really fast, really help, okay? Because if you play a human, if AlphaGo plays a human, it probably takes you 2-3 hours to play a game, right? Really fast game. If you are a long game, could actually last 6 hours, right? But now, if AlphaGo is good enough to play against a human, what can they do? They can play, make AlphaGo play against AlphaGo itself, okay? So now you can play a million games a day, right? What's the implication of that? The implication of that is that AlphaGo can make all the mistakes that a human could ever make in their entire lifetime, 2 or 3 lifetimes probably, okay? And learn from those mistakes and never make those mistakes again, okay? Think about that, okay? Making mistakes really fast and learn from it is what actually makes you smart, okay? So this is the power of the learning loop, all right? Now, a lot of people often ask me, well, what can AI do for me as a business? That really is the wrong question to ask, okay? Because AI could pretty much do everything that we can do as long as we have the data to train it, right? So the real question that you should ask is, what can I digitize? Because if you digitize everything, the key here is fully digitized, right? If you're able to digitize the entire process, every single step of it, right, then you would have the data to train the AI to mimic what a human would have done. Remember, AI is a machine mimicry of human behavior and actions and decisions, right? If you have the data to train it, it will say you will be able to mimic you, right? So if you have a step, you have a process that has 10 steps, right, and you digitize 9 of the steps, don't expect AI to be able to fill in the last step for you. You cannot. It won't be able to. But if you be able to digitize the entire process, then AI could actually pretty much mimic everything that we do. Okay? A little scary, isn't it? Right? Okay. Hopefully now you have a fairly good understanding of what AI work, how AI work, right? Yes, no? Okay. Now we can unravel the market a little bit, okay? So now because there's so many data, so many, today we have big data, right? There's so much data out there. And all AI needs is data, right? So there's actually millions of, I would say, applications of AI out there. But there's actually 4 that's actually very, very important today, okay? First is actually what we call perceptual AI. Perceptual AI is basically, think of them as chatbots and digital assistants, okay? They talk to you, right? They actually can understand your language, right? So the biggest application of these perceptual AI is human-computer interaction, because it's pretty obvious, because if you have a machine that can understand the way, you know, understand your language, to see the world as you do, right? Then, of course, you are going to interact with this machine a lot better, right? Okay. So sometimes these are perceptual AI, it's called cognitive AI. So cognitive computing, cognitive AI, perceptual AI, same thing, okay? So that's that, okay? Another class that's very, very popular is internet AI. So internet obviously generates lots and lots of data, right? And if you feed all those data into a machine, an AI, right, it can actually learn your preference, what you like, what you don't like, right? So these are what we call internet AI. Sometimes they're called personalization AI, because the biggest applications of this internet AI is in personalization. They're creating a recommenders engine to personalize your experience. Okay, so Amazon, Netflix, and Spotify are some of the early pioneers in this, right? So the third class that's actually very, very important today is autonomous AI. So autonomous AI, the biggest application is obviously the self-driving car, right? The autonomous vehicle, right? But you could use it to power robotics, right? Other machines, right? Basically, it's all about machine talking to machine, right? To resolve conflict so they can actually function autonomously, right? So that's autonomous AI, right? The last class is business AI. Business also have lots of data, but not nearly as much as the internet or these perceptual AI, right? But this is the biggest application of this business AI is in what we call business decisions and automation. It helps you make decisions in business and automate those decisions, right? And this tend to be very, very domain specific. So example, you see like here, fraud detection, right? Example here is Watson, right? Watson actually do a lot of machine-aided medical diagnosis, right? Previously, a doctor need to look at, for example, your chest x-ray to determine whether you have cancer or not, right? But if you have give all those x-ray to the machine, to an AI, and tell them, you know, what the, and along with the doctor's diagnosis, right? then the machine could actually mimic what the doctors do, right? And be able to diagnose whether you have cancer or not, looking at future x-rays of people, right? So PROS, where I'm from, is also a kind of business AI, right? And basically, we automate the decision of pricing and opportunity to go after, okay? So I'll tell you a little bit more about that later, okay? So that's the four classes of AI, major applications of AI today, okay? Now, now that you understand the market a little bit, right, it comes down to how do you choose the right AI for your problem that you're trying to solve, okay? So part of doing that comes down to understanding how AI work, which you all do now, okay? But also coming down to whether this AI is going to help you, right? So today, because AI is such a hot topic, every company wanted to say that they do AI, right? You know, basically every technology company, right, they're going to identify some business problem and they're going to create some legacy business logic to address those problems. They package it up and then sell it to you, right? That's what tech companies do, right? Now, because everybody wants to jump on this AI bandwagon, so the easiest thing for them to do is basically say, okay, now I could actually put a perceptual AI on top of this logic, right? And now, all of a sudden, they could say that, hey, my system is smart. My system has AI in it, right? Now, that's not a false claim, right? It's a valid claim, right? They certainly do have AI. But now you all know how the learning loop work. Think about how this is going to help you when every time a user uses the system. What happens when the user uses this system over and over again? This learning loop, this perceptual AI, is going to learn to do what? It's going to learn to interact with you better and better, right? Okay, it's going to learn your business jargon. It's going to learn your accent. It's going to learn the way you talk, your sarcasm, your humor, right? So it will learn to interact with you really, really well, but what's solving the business problem? It's the same logic. That didn't change at all, right? That did not change at all, okay? All right, now I'm not saying that these perceptual AI don't have value. They certainly do have value, right? But the value is in increased productivity of the employee, right? Because now if you have a digital assistant, you could pretty much work anywhere. Right? You could be waiting in line for coffee, and you could actually tell your digital assistant to set up a meeting, send a quick email response, right? You could even tell it to fetch me some data so I have it ready when I'm back to my desk, right? But keep in mind, fetching the data is an SQL query, if you know what that means, okay? It's a query that you execute, right? You simply give this digital assistant the ability to execute that query for you. But the query is the same query. Right? That did not change. It's not helping you solve the business problem any better, right? But it certainly gives you productivity, which is important, right? Okay? Okay, now let's take a look at the difference between a business AI. The business AI actually solves your business problem directly, okay? Solve it directly. So every time you use it, it actually learns and solves your business problem better, right? To illustrate this, I'm going to use a problem, example that of a tool that we produce at PROS. Is called opportunity detection. It's basically a tool that recommends opportunities for the sales. So sales can actually look at the opportunity that's recommended, and then basically they could say, I like this opportunity, I'm going to pursue it, okay? Or you could say that I don't like this opportunity, I'm going to reject it, right? Based on what the sales accept and what the sales reject, this AI will learn and recommend more and more the opportunity that the sales like, okay? Solving your business problem better, right? In the longer run, it's actually going to take feedback data, for example, from which deal actually closed, and be able to recommend more and more of the appropriate opportunity for the sales. Right? Maybe this sales is very ambitious. He selected the biggest deals, but he couldn't close it, right? And this AI is actually going to learn and recommend the opportunity that's more appropriate for the sales, right? Solving your business problem better, right? So the value proposition is a smarter and better decision every single time you use this, okay? Now, what can this four type of business AI, four application, four big major applications of AI do for your business? It can improve your customer experience, it can increase your business efficiency, and it can actually help you grow revenue, okay? Now, depending on what you're trying to accomplish, you would pick different AI to solve this problem, okay? So So basically, there's just four types of AI, right? Now, if your goal is to improve your customer experience, for example, you want to deepen your engagement or boost conversion or gain loyalty, right? Which kind of AI would you use to do this? Perceptual, right? Yeah, good. You're very smart, right? And also internet too, right? Because, you know, perceptual AI, as I mentioned before, right? If you interact with the machine better, right, you're obviously going to have much better customer experience. Personalization AI, internet AI, right? If the machine knows what you like and what you don't like, it can also personalize your experience, give you a much better customer experience too. Okay? What about if your goal is to increase efficiency? Which type of AI would you use? Yeah, okay. So I hear a lot of answers out there. You're all right, okay? This is a very, very crowded space. Lots and lots of AI is created to make business process much more efficient, okay? So in fact, I would say if you want to reduce your bottom line, raise productivity, right? So perceptual AI can certainly increase your productivity, as I mentioned before, right? You could work anywhere now, right? Another way is to replace a worker with a robot, right? So use autonomous AI, right? You can also use, in a certain business, AI can actually address the efficiency problem also, right? So this is actually a very, very crowded space, okay? Now, what about if you want to grow revenue? Which AI would you use? Yeah, there's only pretty much, I would say, business AI, okay? Now, I'm not saying that the other type of AI cannot contribute to revenue growth. It can, but the impact is not direct, okay? So for example, internet AI, right? Or maybe even perceptual AI, right? Perceptual AI, it can actually increase improve your customer experience, make your customer experience a lot better, and therefore, you will presumably like the brand a lot more, and therefore buy from the company a lot more, and therefore increase your revenue, right? So it's an indirect impact. It's indirect impact, right? So every one of these AI can actually drive every one of these outcomes, but the direct impact is where the biggest dots are, okay? Okay. So I am completely out of time, so I'm going to skip this part a little bit, but I do wanted to get to the last part about how we're going to learn to work with AI in the future, okay? So the biggest problem today that limits companies' potential to realize the full potential AI is actually the trust issue. Today, a lot of people don't use AI and don't adopt AI because they don't trust AI. Okay, it's a very, very difficult thing, right? And it's very personal, right? Because how can AI, a machine, do something better than I do, right? So we all have to learn how to work with AI in the future in order to change tomorrow, create a better tomorrow, right? So let's take a look at how AI will shift a human's job in the future, right? Let's take a look at the example with a sales rep. What do a sales rep have to do? Basically, they have to analyze sales transaction, right? And then they have to decide which opportunity to go after. And then after that, they will have to contact these leads, right, the prospects, write them emails, connect them, right, and then maybe set up a meeting, and then eventually go meet them and sell them stuff, right? That's what sales do, right? So today, we already have a tool called opportunity detection. Basically, you just have to give this CRM data to AI, right? And then the AI will actually give you the opportunity that you should go after. And you just have to tell the AI whether you accept or reject this opportunity, okay? And based on what you accept and what you reject, this AI will actually learn and provide better and better opportunity in the future. Eventually, it's going to be able to recommend opportunity that's so good that you will pretty much accept most of it, pretty much all the time, okay? Then what do you need to do? After that, you still need to contact your AI, write them email, right? But why stop there? You can actually give your email to an AI, right? And then this AI will actually learn how to compose email just like you do. And then basically, you will write an email for you. And then you could basically say, oh, I accept this email, send it out. Or I don't accept this email. I need to tweak a little bit here. For this customer, it needs to be a little bit humorous. For this customer, it needs to be a little bit more formal, right? Then as you do this, the AI will learn your style, right? How do you write email? How do you write email to engage your customer, right, in different situations, right? So eventually, you will learn to produce email that's so good that you pretty much will accept every one of them, right? Just go out, right? then you could just automate it, right? But why stop there? You still need to set up a meeting and go meet your prospect, right? So, but you have your calendar data, right? Why not just give those calendar data to AI and let the AI recommend itinerary for you, right? You can, basically, it could recommend itinerary for you, and then you could basically say, I accept this itinerary or I don't, right? And based on what you accept and what you reject, this AI will learn your travel preference and recommend better and better itinerary the way you like, right? And eventually, it's going to be so good that you pretty much accept all the opportunity, all the itinerary that they recommend, right? So now, you can simply just go and meet your customer. That's it, right? Imagine if you have to do all this stuff. How many customers can you meet a month? Probably 5, 10. But if you have AI doing all this thing for you, how many customers can you meet? Maybe 50, maybe 100, okay? So we are basically exchanging data for automation, okay? This is how we're gonna work with AI. So basically, I would also tell you with the ending note that humans have been doing too many mundane and repetitive tasks for too long. Those tasks should have been done by machine a long time ago, okay? With AI automation, we can finally do what we do best and do what we love. Thank you very much. Yeah.